Shalom. This week's Torah portion is Chayei Sara, the life of our matriarch, Sarah. And our Torah portion begins, and the life of Sarah was 100 years, 20 years, and 7 years. These were the years of Sarah's life. The Torah portion is called the life of Sarah, but what does it actually tell us about Sarah's life? Ostensibly nothing. The Parsha begins to speak about Sarah's death and burial, and it details a rather protracted and exhaustive negotiation that Avraham conducted with the children of Chet, with Ephron the Chetite, for the purchase of Marat HaMachpelah, the double cave, for him to bury his wife Sarah. So why is the Parsha called the life of Sarah if actually it talks about the death of Sarah? So our sages teach that this name comes to teach us that the righteous are called living even in death. The tzaddikim, the righteous, are called always alive. And it would seem that this idea of tzaddikim, of the righteous, being called living even in death, has a deeper level of meaning that we can learn from our parsha, which is extremely practical and extremely contemporary, relating to our situation now. See, many commentators ask the question, what's gained by the lengthy discourse that the Torah gives of this whole story? What does it really do for us? Are we gaining some sort of lasting understanding or important lesson by the record of these rather drawn-out negotiations, the conversation relating to the transaction of Avraham and Ephron regarding the price paid and all this business, negotiable currency? Actually, the Midrash relates to this question and stresses that we can learn from this, and this is the expression of the Midrash, we learn from this how important the transaction, the acquisition of a tzaddik, a righteous man, is in Eretz Yisrael, the land of Israel. And here's the language of the Midrash. Said Rabbi Eliezer, how much ink has been spilled and how many quills have been broken in order to write the phrase, the children of Chet, a total of 10 times here in the Parsha? Yeah, it's repeated. B'nei Chet, B'nei Chet. 10 times. Why, continues Rabbi Eliezer in the Midrash? Because the 10 times that B'nei Chet, the children of Chet, is written correspond to the 10 commandments. In order to teach us that whoever seeks to really clarify and understand the acquisition, the purchase of a tzaddik in Eretz Israel, in the land of Israel, is recognized as if he has fulfilled the 10 commandments. So the spilled ink and broken quills that went into the repetition of the writing of the words B'nei Chet, the children of Chet, from whom Avraham purchased the tomb, the double cave, the city of Hebron, those same children of Chet who were the people of Canaan, all this, according to this insight, was to establish the righteousness and the validity of Avraham's purchase and legal acquisition. And seeing as how this place, Hebron, the tomb of the patriarchs, the place of Sarah's burial, became the basis for our roots, for the roots of the nation of Israel and the land of Israel, so it transpires that on one level, yeah, you could say that Sarah did not die, because she continues to serve as an influence and guide even after her death, living amongst us even more than during her life, because the basis of everything is that place. See, our sages consider the purchase of the tomb of the patriarchs in Hebron, which we are reading about in this week's Torah portion, they consider this to be the symbol of the beginning of Israel's, if I may use the word, settlement of the land. And the strength of that purchase is that it cannot be contested by any other nation, by any other party. Famous Midrash states as follows. It's extremely important teaching. It states that there are three places regarding which the nations of the world cannot defraud Israel, as if to say, you're robbers because you've stolen these places. Even though God actually bequeathed the entire land of Israel to the children of Israel, there are three places about which the Torah testifies to an acquisition. And so the nations cannot attempt to defraud Israel by accusing Israel of being robbers. And these are the places: the double cave, the tomb of the patriarchs that we're reading about in this week's Torah portion, and the Holy Temple in Jerusalem, and the burial place of Joseph in Shechem. Regarding the cave, it is written in Genesis 23 and verse 16, "And Avraham heeded Ephron, and Avraham weighed out to Ephron the price which he had stated within earshot of the children of Chet, 400 silver shekels in negotiable currency." Regarding the Holy Temple, it's written in 2 Chronicles. 2 Chronicles 21, 25. "And David gave to Ornan for the place gold shekels weighing 600. And regarding the burial place of Joseph, in Genesis 33 we read, the Torah tells us of Jacob's purchase. He bought the parcel of land upon which he pitched his tent from the children of Hamor, Shechem's father, for 100 kasita. It should be noted that also in the section of the Torah that details the purchase of the threshing floor that became the site of the Holy Temple, Ornan, or Arvona, the Jebusite as he is called, that is also his name, Ornan, is also mentioned 10 times, just as the Midrash cites with regard to the repetition of the name of the children of Chet, because the acquisition of the land of Israel corresponds to the central importance and significance of no less than the Ten Commandments themselves. But I know what you're thinking. Fact remains, obviously, that these three places about which we are told that the nations cannot dispute our ownership and cannot dispute our claim are the places over which there's battle going on, battle for sovereignty, battle for title, battle for recognition of ownership, and, you know, they don't seem prepared to recognize Israel's sovereignty. And this really only goes to prove that they are well aware of the indisputable fact that our nation's connection with the land of Israel is beyond dispute, and that that connection emanates from these locations. And well they know that if they lose their argument concerning these three places, they lose their hold over the entire land, and thus they fight with Israel over these places. And you know what? These three solid purchases testified to by Torah, these three acquisitions which are, and you'll see soon why I'm using this expression, beyond dispute, they represent the three pillars upon which the world stands, in accordance with the Mishnah, teaching of the Mishnah, and the famed chapters of the Fathers states, upon three pillars does the world stand, upon the pillar of Torah, the pillar of the divine service, and on the acts of loving kindness. This is a teaching, three pillars: Torah, Avodah, and Gemilut Chasadim. The Torah, the divine service, and acts of loving kindness are the three pillars upon which the world stands. Well, that corresponds to these three purchases, because Hebron, the city of Hebron, represents chesed, represents kindness, because Avraham, who purchased the Marat HaMachpelah, the double cave, he was the indisputable pillar of kindness. And Hebron is an expression of chaver tov, a good friend, because the Torah describes how Avraham is the friend of God. Mount Moriah, the Temple Mount, obviously represents the Avodah, the divine service, for our forefather Yitzchak, who was bound on the altar on Mount Moriah like an offering, he was the pillar of divine service. And Shechem, the place of the resting place of Joseph, represents Torah itself, because our forefather Yaakov, who purchased Shechem, was the pillar of Torah. As the verse tells us in Genesis 25:27, Jacob was an ish tam, he was a wholesome man, yoshev ohalim, abiding in tents, which is an allusion to a life of Torah study. Because Jacob, Yaakov, studied Torah in the yeshiva of Shem and Ever. And it was also in Shechem, don't forget, that Joshua made a covenant with Israel when they entered into the land, and they swore to Hashem opposite Mount Gerizim and Mount Evel, which was like Israel receiving the Torah all over again. Fast forward to yesterday. Yesterday, Abbas, head of the PLO, spoke to thousands gathered in Ramallah in honor of the 10th anniversary of the death of the arch-murderer PLO leader Yasser Arafat, during which Mr. The New York Times always says Mr. about terrorists, during which Mr. Abbas cautioned the Israeli government against changing the status quo at the Temple Mount. And he said, keep the settlers and the extremists away from Al-Aqsa and our holy places, Abbas demanded. Listen carefully. He said, we will not allow our holy places to be contaminated. The Muslim and Christian worlds will never accept Israel's claims that Jerusalem belongs to them. The Jerusalem that was occupied in 1967, said Mr. Abbas, belongs to us. He said that Israel's leaders are making a big mistake if they think they can turn back history to impose a reality. And that, of course, is very funny. And I really, this is a part that I really enjoy. I never tire of this, and you may have seen it before, but here we have this booklet published by the Muslim Waqf in 1924. Here in Jerusalem, the Supreme Muslim Council, it's an English language guidebook to the Temple Mount. It's called A Brief Guide to Al-Haram al-Sharif Jerusalem. So here is Abbas talking about how the Israeli leaders had better not turn back history and better not impose a reality because, what was it that he said? He said that the Jerusalem that was occupied in 1967 belongs to us. But here we read as follows. It's just absolutely amazing. And by the way, when this booklet was republished after the establishment of the State of Israel in 1948, the entire contents was changed and what I'm about to read was expunged. But here we read, the site is one of the oldest in the world. Its sanctity dates from the earliest, in parentheses, perhaps from prehistoric times. Its identity with the site of Solomon's temple is beyond dispute. This, too, is the spot, according to the universal belief, on which David built there an altar unto the Lord and offered burnt offerings and peace offerings, which, of course, is a quotation from 2 Samuel 24:25. You can actually order this, quantities of it, at templemountguide@gmail.com. So this is really amazing, and man, I would like to talk about this all day long because I just think it's so really just beyond anything, considering what the man is saying this week and considering this revisionist history. But of course today, we're talking about Marat HaMachpelah. We're talking about the tomb of the patriarchs, but the Midrash that we quoted earlier has already made clear the relationship between all of these places and why it is so necessary that certain people need to deny Israel's connection to them. It reminds me of a teaching in the Holy Zohar. See, I've been fond for many years now of teaching and reminding everybody about why this cave is so special. Just to briefly summarize the most profound teaching, right? Avraham, he inadvertently made a discovery in that cave. He discovered that Adam and Chava, Adam and Eve, were lying there in repose. He discovered that the place, this field that belonged to Ephron in Hebron, the cave of the that became the tomb of the patriarchs, is actually the entrance to the Garden of Eden. And from the moment he discovered it, we are taught, he discovered it inadvertently chasing after a calf that ran in there, because he was chasing after this calf, actually hobbling the 99-year-old man that just had this his circumcision, but interrupted everything when these three angels, whom he actually thought were idolaters who bowed down to the dust of their feet, but he was so committed to chesed, to kindness, that he wanted to make them a meal. So he's chasing after this calf to prepare a meal, and it runs in there. And that's how he discovered it. And from that moment, he just pined for this place. That's the teaching. And that means so much on many levels. On one thing it means is that it shows us that Avraham, he was the continuation of Adam. the legacy of Adam. That's why he so much wanted to be in the place of Adam, because he was willing to take responsibility for the work of Adam in fixing the world. And two, the other thing that we learn from this tale, if you would, that is so powerful, is that the entrance to the Garden of Eden is discovered, as it were, is entered into through acts of loving kindness, because all Avraham was really trying to do was prepare a meal for these people. But this is the point. Ephron, this is the teaching of the Holy Zohar. Ephron, he looked into that cave too, and all he saw was darkness. Couldn't understand why anybody would really want it and make a big deal about it. And as the Holy Zohar states, if Ephron had seen in the depths of that cave what Avraham had seen, he never would have sold it. But he couldn't see anything. I'll tell you what that means to me, what it reminds me of. Because, you see, the vision, the hookup, it only works for Avraham. It only works for his descendants when we are here. And, you know, try as they might, others might try to deny that connection, to undermine Israel. The connection works with Avraham and with his children. Ephron could see nothing. So here you have attempts that are constantly being made as we read these very Torah portions, as we read the very Torah portion of our deepest roots in this land and the acquisition, beyond dispute, of Marat HaMachpelah. Abbas is accusing us of rewriting history, of creating a new reality. Let's have a little historical review of this land, you know, following the destruction of the Holy Temple, the exile of the people of Israel. What was the situation in this land which was dubbed by Rome Palestine as a pejorative, not after a people named Palestinian, since there is no indigenous people called Palestinians, no Palestinian language, no Palestinian history? What was the situation here before the era of prosperity that we are currently in, which began with the late 19th century renewal of Jewish land settlement? So a periodic review indicates that this land was virtually laid waste. Its population suffered acute decline. Dio Cassius, writing at the time, described the ruin of the land beginning with the destruction of Judah. He writes, "The whole of Judea became desert, as indeed had been foretold. For the tomb of Solomon, whom these folks celebrated in their sacred rites, fell of its own accord into fragments and wolves and hyenas, many in number, roamed howling through the cities." One historian after another has reported the same findings in the 12 and a half centuries between the Arab conquest in the 7th century and the beginnings of the Jewish return in the 1880s. This place called Palestine was laid waste, and it was absolutely desert and desolation. Under the Ottoman Empire of the Turks, the policy of disfoliation continued. The hillsides were denuded of trees and the valleys were robbed of their topsoil. And in 1590, a simple English visitor, he described himself as, to Jerusalem wrote, "Nothing there is to be seen but a little of the old walls which is yet remaining, and all the rest is grass, moss, and weeds, much like to a piece of rank or moist ground." And while Tiberias was being resettled by Jews from papal states whose migration was approved by a papal bull, Nazareth was continuing its decline. A Franciscan pilgrim translated a Latin manuscript that reported that it's all a house of robbers, murderers, the inhabitants are Saracens. It's a lamentable thing to see such a town. We saw nothing more than stony, full of thorns and deserts. And the reports go on and on. In the mid-1700s, British archaeologist Thomas Shaw wrote that the land in Palestine was lacking in people to till its fertile soil. An 18th century French author and historian, Count Constantine Francois Volney, wrote of Palestine as the ruined and desolate land. And the list is very long. From place to place, the reporters vary, but not the reports. J.S. Buckingham described his visit of 1816 to Jaffa, which has all the appearances of a poor village, and every part of it that we saw was of corresponding meanness. After a visit in 1817-1818, travelers reported that there was not a single boat of any description on the Lake of Tiberias. It was described in 1827 by a German encyclopedia as desolate and roamed through by Arab bands of robbers. Throughout the 19th century, abandonment and dismal state of the terrain was lamented. In 1840, an observer who was traveling through observed that the once populous area between Hebron and Bethlehem was now abandoned and desolate and dilapidated. It goes on and on. British Council in Palestine in 1857 reported that the country is in a considerable degree empty of inhabitants, and therefore its greatest need is that of a body population. And of course, most famously, Mark Twain, in his inimitable fashion, expressed scorn for what he called the romantic and prejudiced accounts of Palestine after he visited the Holy Land in 1867. In one location after another, Mark Twain registered gloom at his findings. He writes, "Stirring scenes occur in the valley," meaning Jezreel, "no more. There is not a solitary village through its whole extent, not for 30 miles in either direction. There are two or three small clusters of Bedouin tents, but not a single permanent habitation. One may ride 10 miles hereabouts and not see 10 human beings." He says it's the sort of solitude to make one dreary. He says, "Come to Galilee for that. Those unpeopled deserts, these rusty mounds of barrenness that never, never do shake their glare from their harsh outlines and fade and faint into vague perspective, the melancholy ruin of Capernaum, the stupid village of Tiberias slumbering under its six funeral palms. We reached Tabor safely. We never saw a human being on the whole routes. The whole land is a solitude that is inhabited only by birds of prey and skulking foxes. Palestine sits in sackcloth and ashes, desolate and unlovely," he wrote. "It is dreamland." And many other writers, such as the Reverend Samuel Manning, mourn the atrophy of the coastal plain, the Sharon plain, the exquisite fertility of, to the Hebrew mind, a symbol of prosperity. But my point is, where were the inhabitants? Well, report followed by depressing report. As the economist historian Professor Fred Gothel pointed out, a desolate country, a wretched desolation and neglect, almost abandoned, unoccupied, uninhabited, not populated. Summarized by David Landis, the causes of the shriveling number of inhabitants were the result of centuries of Turkish neglect, misrule. Following on the earlier ravages of successive conquerors, the land had been given over to sand, marsh, the Anopheles mosquito, clan feuds, Bedouin marauders. A population of several million had shrunk to less than one-tenth that number, perhaps a quarter of a million around 1800, and 300,000 at mid-century. But where are the Palestinians? And you know that there's an old joke, retold with various slight changes, that goes something like this. And I wish it were true. Prime Minister of Israel sits down with Arafat at the beginning of negotiations regarding the resolution of the conflict, and the Prime Minister requests that he be allowed to begin with a story. And Arafat says, "Of course." The Prime Minister begins his story. "Years before the Israelites came to the Promised Land and settled here, Moses led them for 40 years throughout the desert. The Israelites began complaining that they were thirsty, and lo and behold, a miracle occurred. And a stream appeared before them. They drank their fill and decided to take advantage of the stream to do some bathing. And that included Moses. But when Moses came out of the water, he found that all his clothing was missing. 'Who took my clothes?' Moses asked those around him. 'It was the Palestinians,' replied the Israelites." "Wait a minute," objected Arafat immediately. "There were no Palestinians during the time of Moses." "All right," replies the Prime Minister in the joke. "Now that we've got that settled, let's begin our negotiations." Halavai, we say, if only we had such a mentality in our government. But the God of Israel, indeed, not just promised, but covenanted the entire land to the people of Israel. But the tomb of the patriarchs, Hebron, the Temple Mount, Jerusalem, the tomb of Joseph, Shechem, these are living proofs, testimonies beyond dispute, that the land of Israel belongs to the people of Israel. And indeed, the tzaddikim, the righteous people, our forefathers, are alive. And the land of Israel is alive with her children. Am Yisrael Chai, the people of Israel, are alive.